Well, so we start this lecture, and we start this lecture. It is, in a sense, continuation and an upgrade of previous lecture about learning and induction. Well, overview is first we mention very general comments on the scientific method, then we go to customer or user behavior and learning based on this and concentrate on higher dimensions. Then we come back to this master and PhD thesis, which we were mentioning at the previous lecture on semantization, when we mention some startup idea where the data cube can be seen as a screen for customer, and then some comments, more comments on learning. Well, so let's start on the scientific method. Well, of course, we can distinguish discovery and invention. And global picture from the previous lecture is this, that a scientific method is just a process. We make observation, then we think about interesting question, formulate hypothesis. We should be able to test this hypothesis, and maybe then we evaluate this, maybe we have to refine this, and if we are successful, maybe we can develop general theories. So this is a, in a sense, simplification, because I would, of course, example of this is discussion about global warming and what is very actual today about the coronavirus and disease. But also there is another approach of Albert Einstein where his impulse came mainly from the theory. So he developed a very general theory of relativity, and then he proposed some testable predictions, and we will speak about this. But anyway, this I personally I'm not a physicist, and I consider this not maybe it was influenced by some observations from physics in the 19th century, but I consider this this impulse as a theoretical impulse. So besides observation, then can be a theoretical impulse. And for us, it is now a question whether our customer preference, probably it will be an invention. It is not a discovery of something what exists. And but it can be based on some discoveries, maybe in psychology, sociology, marketing, and who knows, maybe in some other disciplines. Well, so come back to Einstein. So Einstein, general theory of relativity, he predicted that, for instance, if there is a sun and there is a star, so this light coming to the observer here is bended here by the gravitation of sun. So observer, in fact, he sees this star here in this position. And similar, this star here, the trajectory of the light is bended here by the big gravitation of the sun. And so the observer, physicist, sees the star here. So the hypothesis was that we can observe some gravitational deflection. Okay? And now it is a generally accepted theory. But what is interesting, that more or less when Einstein published his work and then it came to discussion, so there was a discussion in the 1919-1920, the citations are here. So all of these. So let's try to switch off this pointer. So here are you see some URL. Here is a URL. Here is a URL. So all these papers here, all these texts and data are given, and so they made some measurements. And if you see this gravitational deflection, or this bending of this light, was measured here, and so these results were not very convincing. So in these years they didn't believe that this, at least some authors, some results permit a decision for or against the Einstein deflection hypothesis. And moreover, here these authors in the 1980, well, in historical studies, they were discussing a hypothesis that maybe after the World War I, and because Einstein was German and they lost the war, and so they wanted to make some good face to Germans, and so maybe politics played also the role that somehow it was supported. Well, so this is the historical question from 1980. And in 2001, these two authors give some more arguments why it was really these measurements by... So there was a... If you would like to make this measurement for Sun, you cannot measure the star which is close to Sun, because Sun is shining. So you have to wait for an eclipse, Sun eclipse. Here is the Sun, here is the corona. So these stars inside the corona you cannot follow. And then all these are the changes in the place where the stars appeared before coming close to Sun and during this Sun eclipse. So we can see that there is a clear measurement that there is really some phenomena of this gravitational deflection. And these authors, moreover, show that even the original measurements of this Eddington expedition, it was measured in Antarctica in 1919 when there was this Sun eclipse. And so they show that these historians are really not very, very correct. And moreover, what they mention is that media, it seems, they don't like representing science in a way it is actually. Science is messy. Some people doubt here, or some historian doubt, or here is some result. So there is always some conflict, some messy. Of course, there is no doubt about the urban pollution, it is bad, but we will also show on the next example on the global warming problem, also the science is messy. Let's see. Well, global warming, is it a mass, conflict, politics, what is everything behind this? So there are again some pointers. So here you see it is about from the Nature, a paper, a picture. This is from Georgia State University, from some climate literacy lab. And this here is a link to some archive paper of two Finnish physicists. And what we can see, if we look more closely to this, so I again can switch in this laser pointer, what we can see, so because imagine here are data for 450,000 years. And we are here, so it is ice sheet growth is inverted, so this is the smallest ice sheet maybe in Greenland. But it is not special only for this global warming now, warming last years, because we can see that around the year 1000, 100,000, I don't know exactly, 30. And then there were several warming periods, and these are interglacial. The same is for the measurement of some molecules of oxygen, so maybe this is deuteronomium, I am not sure now. And this is about the concentration of carbon dioxide. And again we see that, okay, it's true that today is the high concentration, but it was even in the year 130,000 where there was no industry. And it was several times in these 450,000 years. Same measurement is here, because they again, by some other method and some other experiments, they measure, you see, this green line is temperature, and these dots are carbon dioxide concentration. I asked a physicist from Charles University how it is possible to measure things like this, and he says that the temperature influences molecules of oxygen and some variations in, and so if you go deeply in the Greenland ice, then you can measure how many special molecules with some special properties on the atomic level can be found. What we see that again here, because well, here we are today, you see, so here is this temperature, this global warming. Yes, it's true, there is a global warming last maybe 10,000 years, but here was an ice age. And here's this global warming, so this is the interglacial, and this is the interglacial, and these are glacial periods. And what we see that this warming here in the last interglacial period was even bigger than today. Okay? And these Finnish authors, they show that the model which is used by United Nations organization for these climate studies do not consider cloudliness. And they show that there is a correlation in variation of cloudliness, so it is measured by some percentage of clouds and the amount of sun which is going through. And this is the development of the temperature from the year 1980, maybe 1980. And we see that there is a correlation. Of course, here is the Pinatubo vulcan explosion, here is El Niño effect, and the temperature was higher, but also clouds were correspondingly reacting. So we see that there is a correlation. So final, in one of these papers, they make this statement on the effect of human activity of climate change is insignificant. So the most viable hypothesis for the cause of glacial, interglacial carbon dioxide change involved a lot of other parameters is caused by biological production, because we know that trees are producing carbon dioxide, for instance, and maybe much more than cars. And in this time here, there were no cars, of course. Okay. So the last example is a mathematical model about the coronavirus, and this is spread. And here is again the citation to this paper from Disease of Poverty Journal, and there is again the URL behind this image. And the model is the following. So probably the virus was brought by bats. There are some unknown hosts. There was a reservoir of this virus, probably this seafood market in the Wuhan, and here it comes to people. And now, how it is really this transmission working? So here are these equations. So the partial derivation of this SB in time is depending on this in this way. So this is a pure mathematical assumption that this is in sense linear, then this EB is here again influenced by all these parameters IB and RB. So these are partial derivatives by time. So how does it change in time as these beds are flowing? And I am not going now into details. We can read this paper if you wish. And then there are equations about these hosts, you see here. And then probably here by human this SP, and I didn't copy everything because it wouldn't be readable. So there are another, I don't know, maybe 7 or 10 lines of equations. And why I am showing this? I am showing this that a lot of these models are just based on an assumption. Well, so in a sense we believe that the world is nice and behaves nice and mathematically nice, and everything can be described by some partial differential equations. And what we see now that in this physical or life sciences, okay, so there were these examples about from Einstein theory or from this global warming or this virus in this life sciences or medical domain. In all cases, we have a lot of data and we can measure whether this model fits or not. If we need, we send a expedition to Arctis and we measure sun eclipse measurement of this star light bending and so on. So in a sense all these general theories, physics and life sciences, they assume there is a one world. Physics is everywhere the same. Warming is only one model of warming, and so on. Of course, it can be influenced on some currents in the sea and so on. But all of these, and here is this United Nations panel for climate change, and these Finnish authors, they claim that this circulation model is not good because they don't consider this cloudiness. Okay, coronavirus. So all these here, this group of sciences, have at least a lot of data. Of course, they are not unified in views, there can be discussion, there can be mess, there can be journalists and politicians and whoever. But what is special with us, that we really don't have that much data. Each, and no uniform human behavior, each human is maybe different. So we cannot find a single model and then just try and test and measure on humans. And moreover, for each single user and for each single customer, we have only very limited data. Because this customer visits our web page, maybe makes 2, 3, or 4 clicks, and then he is away. So what we did here, so these models here we have seen are a little bit borrowing from physics. Some partial derivation, partial differential equations, even in this coronavirus. Here, we cannot make derivation because here it is very discrete in time. So our assumption is a theory of ideal points, where some people in marketing agree with this. And then, so this is a model of human and this is a model of resources. So we have two models of humans and of resources, and probably if we are able to make a better semantization, maybe we can better automize approach to bigger amount of web resources in an automated way. So this semantization can help us. Okay, so these were very general comments to scientific method. Now, let us come to the second point of this lecture today, and it is about a new view on, or extended view on linear monotone preference model. Why did we these models? Well, we hoped it will be intuitive, it will be easy to explain for untrained user, And for me personally, there is no coding, no clicking library methods for data mining. Rather, we concentrate on principles. Sometimes it happens that it would be better if we could have higher dimensions. We already mentioned in Tableau lecture that if these dimensions are small categorical dimensions, then we can use ceteris paribus with this Tableau. But if these dimensions are true dimensions, continuous linearly ordered dimensions, then we have so far no model. So today I would like to present you a possibility how to make a linear monotone preference model for four dimensions. So we use and we recall this data which we generated in the lecture 7. So if you remember, you can go back to lecture 7. So this was a peak user. We took this data generated in the preference cube, and then we found data in the data cube. Similarly, there was a valley user, and the same data from preference group, but with different attribute preferences were again found in some good distribution in the data cube. Well, now let us look to this in such a way that we have one user, one single user, which has peak-like preferences in two attributes, A1, A2, so in domains D1, D2. And then in the attributes A3 and A4, this same user has valley-like preferences, and this will be in D3 and D4 domains. And in both domains, well, this was a little bit simple start for this generation of data. In both of these domains, these pairs, it has the same combination of preferences. So if here is the preference degree for the first attributes, and so then the global preference in this peak valley preference is by this formula, by our linear monotone preference model, and in the valley preference is by this formula. But you see, if you multiply this by 3, so you cancel out these 3, and you get a formula where you have 2x1 plus x2 plus 2x3 plus x4. And if you divide it by 6, you get overall preference of the all four attributes by this weight here. So one user, and of course this data generation could have been more general, but as we did it, we concentrate only on this case. Now I repeat how it was with this peak user in one split, and it was the combination of these methods M2 and A1, and we got these test points for this one single case. For the valley user, we used the method M1 prime because we took only the smallest preferences, and here in the mean, we can find the probably the zero point of the preferences, and we assume that we have a valley preference, so the ones are here in the corner, and similarly here. And then when I have this, then the method A1 tells me take these points with pairs of points with smaller preference. Use this estimation of the attribute preference to find the images here, and this defines some contour lines. And here, because we have three of these points, there is a pair of contour lines, so we take this angle of these two lines. So this will be our estimation of the contour line. Now, again, we can do, because we have the same split, so we have these testing items, and we make images of testing items. So these items are here A, C, and B. So the images, by this estimation of the attribute preferences, and these attribute preferences are here, here are the estimations, and here is the contour line, and so we can, on the, because we know that the overall preference can be read on this diagonal in the preference cube, so we see that A3 has this much preference, B3 has this much, and C4 has this much. And here we were, in previous case, we were calculating the error. But now, what we do, we put all these four dimensions into one picture. So this line is both the D1, so the domain of attribute 1, but also the domain of attribute 3. And this line is domain of both second and the fourth attribute. And this preference degree here is both x1, x3, so we distinguish them by colors. So red ones are attributes 1 and 2, and the blue ones are attribute 3 and 4. Of course, these points in data cube are different because these are were generated, remember, by points in preference cube, so we have different positions. And what we can now do? How can we aggregate this? Okay, we can aggregate it in the same way as we were calculating, remember, this group preference. In the lecture 2, we presented this method here just for making a group preference. But now, so this here is the copy of this preference cube from here. Okay, so here is the preference cube, here is the copy, and now, because we have these preference degrees on this diagonal, so we try to bring them to this cube. So here is the attribute 1 and 2 preference degree, here is the attribute 3 and 4 preference degree, here is the zero point, here is the ideal point. And moreover, for this aggregation, as we have shown before, we have more or less average value is the overall preference. And now we make images, but we make images not from points, but from the points where the corresponding intersection from the diagonal and this contour line is. So here is the intersection, here, and here. And so we get, of course, these blue points have to be brought here, to this axis, and now the point A, it has first two attributes preference degree, this one, second and third and fourth attribute degree here. So here is the true two dimensional version. So this is the y12 and this is the y34 in this formula. The same for the point B, and same for the point C. And now you see, here you have these true estimated images of these points after the four-dimensional data mining. And now, because these two points should have preference degree 0.3, and here is the line 0.3, so here is the first error of the point A of the prediction, here is the error of prediction of point B, and here is the error of prediction of point C. And this line were really, they are really relative to this length of this diagonal, so this is in the 0.3 part of the diagonal, and this here is a 0.4 diagonal. All these errors from here are copied, brought here, and measured together, and it gives the error. For this split, for these methods, so the error is 0.18. Of course, we have to do it for all splits and all combinations of methods, but we are not going this way. Anyway, it shows that by such a construction, which was already used for group preferences, can we also use it for making learning preference and estimation of these errors of methods in the four-dimensional case. Well, okay. So now, okay. I have a problem here. I have a problem here. I have a problem here. So I have go here and I have to stop. Not stop. I have to pause. Okay, so it was paused because there was a problem on the slide. Slide 18. And because there was from some previous recording, there was some voice. Okay, so we finished this four-dimensional learning and we came to general considerations and some experiments on supervised learning. So in general, we have in learning, we have some input space of some variables. We call it independent variables. And then we either have a property in classifications of class of items with this property, or this property has some value, some numerical values, and then this is called a regression task. And these variables, either classification or regression variables, are called dependent variables. And the learning is called supervised if we have by human a train set where we know at least some examples of these independent variables and dependent variables. And then the learning in general, we have to choose some learning algorithm from some space of some functions, because we would like to approximate this function here by another function. This can be some Bayesian network, some decision tree, neural network, deep network. It can be Fagin-Lotem-Naur class function or a simplification of the Fagin-Lotem-Naur, namely the linear monotone preference model. And finally, we have to choose also some measure, how we measure the success of learning, how this function is a good estimation or approximation of this here, and a good estimation and generalization for the future. So these are some main points of learning, and we will show how this was really applied. So already in the lecture about semantization, I showed you this. This was a master thesis. This was the task, and what we came, probably we need some learning because we have some human observation, maybe domain experts, some design patterns, where who is using these design patterns when he designed this web page of these hotels, and we can look for patterns in the source code. So probably there can be some machine learning methods which can discover these frequent patterns. So finally, this author, Maruščák, decided to use also some data mining or some learning, where the these independent variables were a DOM tree, so a representation of this XHTML source of this page. And the dependent variable was some part of the tree where he could say, oh, this is here a data record, or the whole here is a data region. How it was done? Of course, he used some training data, some examples of some web pages. And the idea was that if you consider the tree of this HTML or XHTML, the source code of this web page, then this here, these data records and data regions will be quite low in the tree. So the tree could here contain some data region on some low level, and even lower there will be data records, and here will be attribute values. Maybe a picture, maybe a text, and so on. Of course, it happens sometimes, and this was the main obstacle for this simple-minded idea, is that some data records consisted of two subtrees. Because we see this as a user, we see this as a single record, but maybe inside the HTML there is an element with this picture, then there is an element with this text, and then there is an element with here with these prices maybe. So more or less what he had to do, and he did it, so he made a similarity between pairs or even triples of subtrees. And if you have in the training data this annotated, that this is a good element for a data record, then using this this learning you could discover also other data records. And for the similarity, the Levenstein similarity of the subtrees was used, and it was optimized correctly with respect to the identification of subtrees. And this Levenstein similarity, it had some threshold, and for different domains it could be and would be necessary to use a different one. Here we are again so sorry for small interruption. So the second project was this diploma thesis by Fisher. Here you see what was done in the semantization lecture. And again, the problem was probably to use some data mining. Nevertheless, this project was really very time-consuming and needed a lot of coding. So only small experiments were done with respect to some precision recall measures we will mention later. So, but it was prepared for this learning. So there were these independent variables, there were these dependent variables, but no extensive learning. So sometimes you have to prepare data for the learning by some extensive coding. The third project was the PhD thesis of Jan Dědek. Again, it was clear that if we have some, for instance, these acquisitions, then we have to recognize by some learning these items here, who is buying whom and what is the price and so on, and to be able to generalize it. So the solution of Jan Dědek was the following, that he used a tool of our linguist. In our building in the fourth floor there is a department of computational linguistics, and what they are doing, that well, it is not this text, but here is the text. They represent the text in the dependency tree. So for instance, if you read here the sentence, the new Audi has a advanced sound system with speakers and channels and many energy, then you can make a tree of this sentence. But what is important, these linguists have a tool which makes these trees in an automated way. And now when we are interested, for instance, in which car and which company produced the sound system, so you can make this training data by annotating parts of this tree. And if you do it for enough big number of trees, then you are probably able to learn some patterns of this training data. So what is the x variable? X variables are this text, and the y, the dependent variables, is what, who, where, when. So for instance, here in which car and in by which company the sound system. And it was a quite successful PhD thesis, and he used some natural language processing from Sheffield University, and also from our Czech linguist in our faculty. The last project, if you remember, again, there is some problem with the sound. Sorry. So we have to go to this fourth project of Ivo Lašek and this disambiguation. And again, the task was described in the lecture on semantization, and the solution was following. He took a dump of all Wikipedia articles, and the idea was that if I am trying to distinguish between this Apple, which is a company producing music records, and this Apple, which we know is a computer science IT company, how can I do it? Try to find collocations with other entities. And for instance, this Apple record, this musical records was quite often, 25 times in the whole Wikipedia dump, and this IT company was 22 times mentioned in the same paper with the Pixar company. So now, if you get a new paper, so you look to the neighborhood and you can see either there are some occurrences of some other which usually appear together with this music record, or there are occurrences of some other which usually appear with this IT company. And if it is wrong, so IT company with Badfinger was only once, and even music records with Pixar was zero, so never appeared in the whole Wikipedia. And then the evaluation, it was at the conference of National Institute of Standards, so 71% of these disambiguations were correct, 11% were not correct, but because of missing candidates, 9% incorrect disambiguation, so this was really a mistake. This was false positive, this false negative, and sometimes it was because the spelling was different or there were some missing values. Okay, the last project which mentioned we here is the project of this customer preference learning by Alan Eckhart and Ladislav Peška. And what we see here, okay, you can read this general comments. But what we see you here is the preference cube. So here is the ideal point, but we shifted it to the point 1.1. And so it was a geometrical intuition behind this. So if I know that the item S2 has a preference 0.8, then probably everything was is northeast, so this preference cube is in the opposite direction as we are used from our LPMP method. And this S1 has a preference 1.0, and everything northeast is at least 1.0. And S3 has preference 0.6, and everything what is here is at least 0.6. And now, here, if a new item comes, you can make a connection of this item to this ideal point, S0, and you can calculate the ratio of distance to 0.8 and to 0.6 contour line, so to say, or this at least the space where it is really dominating. And by this ratio, you can assign to this point 0.68. So you can read further papers by Alan Eckhart. And with Ladislav Peška, we did also something, similar. So imagine these are already projections of your point from data cube to the attribute preference function. So here is the domain of attribute, here is the rating, the preference degree, here are all projections of items. And then you can use some regression to try to find, you think this is a peak preference, and probably you can have two different methods, and one gives you this blue generalization or estimation, and another gives you this red estimation, and these are also possible ways how to try to construct an estimation of the user preference. Last mention is from information retrieval, where we have classification data. We have again. You can imagine training data, where there are classes about regions, industries, and subject for different papers, and this form the training data. And if a new article comes, so you would like to say, well, what is this about? Oh, it comes from China. Okay, maybe it also can go to some industries, but we don't have this airline industry, or we don't have this subject here, so it goes for regions. So you can read more. This is a lecture from Stanford University, and the book was published in Cambridge University Press, and this lecture, because there are three authors, so this Manning is from Stanford, this Raghavan is from Google, and Schütze is from Munich, and here you can go and more deeply to this subject if you are interested. So now we are slowly coming to finishing of our semantization vision, where I told you that we would like to help the users search the web in an automated way. And what we did, some prototypes and experiments. Of course, my students did it. And so there are this extractor, there is this this annotation server of Fisher, and here is this information extraction by Lashek, and here is the named entity disambiguation, and here is this customer preference learning by Eckhart and Peshkar. So we did some experiments. We showed that the learning and how the learning can be used. Of course, there are probably much more for future work ideas and problems. Well, what I would like now to mention you here is an idea for a lean startup. So imagine you are at the server, you are the one who is programming this server, and you can watch either explicitly evaluation of user or some implicit user behavior, which you interpret as preferences. And you have some estimated contour lines, for instance, at some high level, and you would like to recommend the user with some unseen object. You can imagine that the user has a slider, and he can slide this to 0.7, but maybe higher or lower, depending on how he will go in this search. And so now in our results for this method M2 and A2, we would like to show idea of a startup where the data cube can be seen as a screen. So this is the main idea. It should be intuitive, it should be understandable, self-explainable. So I will show you this. So imagine, so we are always in this C1 split and always in this methods M2, A2, and the 0.7 contour lines in the data cube looks like this. In the C2 split, it looks like this, because this was the preference, attribute preference, and this was the estimation of the, so you see here is the 0.7, because here is 0.5, 6, 7 contour line. And in the C3 split, this is the 0.7 contour line. And now we can see it together. So more or less what we see is that the first and the third split more or less give the same contour lines, and more or less they give the same even the aggregation. Only the second split is different, but we don't know which is best. So here is the aggregation, so the optimal point for the first and third split, and here is the ideal point for the second split. So we can make some average. So this is some average of this learning, and here is some average on these contour lines. And now we can continue with these red elements as the information which we were learning and which we know as estimation. And now imagine, this is a now this is the data cube, just making bigger, and this is the what we know in our model. And here is the user, and maybe he will this shift this slider. This is the best what he was seeing, so probably in this 0.7, and he can go down, he can go higher. And if he is clicking to some point, which is where some, you see here these points are the ideal points of this estimation. So this is this red point, because here were two ideal points, and here is the second split ideal point. So this is something like a center of mass of these ideal points. And maybe this U1 is unseen, so this U means unseen. So there are three unseen objects here close to this estimated ideal point. And if he is clicking maybe in our startup, he will see this car, and if he is going here closer, then he can see some attributes. But maybe he would like to go outside of this region, and he is clicking here, and he sees this car, which was previously seen, and maybe this way he can compare and make a decision which car he will probably going to buy. Well, now let us finish this. So this is a proposal of a possible lean startup. Okay, so what we can moreover learn from our data mining in these linear monotone preference models, here are the true data which we were generating from this preference cube, as it was explained in the last lecture. And this is the attribute preference, and here is the true contour line 0.7. Now, if I compare this true one, this green one, with this which was learned, and this is the average of the estimation, and here is the average of the aggregation. So what we see here, our learning is claiming that what is inside the this red is a true 0.7 or more preference degree items. But what we see, these are true positive, but these are false positive, because these are not in the true 0.7. So we can calculate something, what is true or false, positive or negative. Here is false negative, because this should have been appeared in the estimation of 0.7, but it was outside. So this is a false negative, and this is a true negative. Okay? So this way we can, probably you can, if you would like, I can give you this PowerPoint file to make these experiments easier. Many experiments can be done, and of course I expect your virtual lean startup project. I presented a Google Drive link on the classroom page, and I am expecting your contribution. We have to discuss about the time. Maybe we can make some personal meeting after Easter. Well, the last part, I would like to add some more information. Sometimes this evaluation, how good it is, this learning in a case of numeric data, can be root mean square error, where I calculate the true preference degree and the estimated. And it can be by L2 matrix, L1 matrix, by some similarity. And here you can see, okay, so here are again some links. You can see to Wikipedia. Most of these links is to Wikipedia. And this is the Kendall rank correlation coefficient. And you can at least get an idea what everything is used here in such a data mining. Of course, there is a big difference between order concordance. So what is for us important? Important is that the order is correct or the values. Because, to be honest, when we are making customer preferences and some recommendation, it is not important that we are good in root mean square error, because more important is that the order is in the right shape. Okay, so this is just a toy example, which data from here were used for this picture. Okay, and okay, so last but one lecture slide is this. So preference learning, I try to finish and to conclude these two lectures, is a regression task. Usually we use a supervised learning, so we have a train set where we know how these independent and dependent variables are coupled together. In the test set, we get only some properties of these items, these independent variables. And here, this question sign should be inserted by some tool, by some learning tool. And then it can be compared to some test set, which can be some simulation data, it can be offline data, or even this can be online behavior. So if you observe these user parameters, maybe this is some prediction of what we would like to make our recommendation in online. Of course, methods can be different, can be statistical, can be some recommender systems, there is in the lecture of Ladja Peška, which is lecturing on this, he's from our department. And what we really used is a special case, a linear case of Fagin-Lottenauer class of functions. Okay, thank you very much, and see you next time on the web. Okay. Aha, so maybe I didn't switch off this, so I have to